Well, thank you very much. I'm going to try to use the mouse, which is in the little corner. My hands are too big. I have fat fingers. Oh, sorry. Sorry. So it's great to be here. Thank you, Paul. It's always great to see the growth of this meeting and the excitement. Start will work? Yes. All right. So tricuspid regurgitation, where is it? Here. Do you see it?
There you go. It's on this monitor.
Yeah, it is, but it's not. Okay, all right. So here is a tricuspid valve. This is for the interested, the core people who really want to know something about the tricuspid. So here is the tricuspid. And the title of the talk is A Public Health Crisis. So what is a public health crisis? So there is no definition that I found in the internet, but I suppose that it's a frequent condition, a condition which is deadly, and a condition which is poorly treatable or poorly treated. So then maybe Ebola doesn't touch much people in the US, but TR does, and we're going to see that. So what is the burden, really, of TR of tricuspid regurgitation in the population? And here is a study that was published years ago by the Framingham Heart Study, because they do systematic echoes, and they say, okay, what do we see on the echoes? But when you do that in a population that is mostly healthy, you see here the cases that they have in men and in women, they have very few cases, and it's very difficult to say anything, maybe a little bit more in women than in men, but it's very difficult to conclude anything because the number of their cases is not high. And then the people who do the echo, who see mostly normal echoes, are not really motivated to look at the valves very well. So the issue is to say, okay, what do we have, where do we go? We go to community analysis, and here is our community in Minnesota, Rochester, Minnesota, and in that community, what is interesting is because there is only one echo lab, or there was only one echo lab, we have all the diagnosis of valvular heart disease in the community, everybody diagnosed. We have everything to treat them so we can analyze what is the treatment of these people, and the outcomes and treatment are easily defined. So community, much more interesting in valvular heart disease than the secondary analysis of systematic echoes done for something else. So what we find is this type of patient with big hearts that are referred because they have a big heart, nobody hears a murmur, and the patient is just tired, and then we do the echo, and on the echo, we see this kind of tricuspid regurgitation, nobody heard a murmur, but then the echo makes the diagnosis for this patient. So when we look at the burden in our community, what we see is that here is the burden of tricuspid. All left-sided valve disease, the tricuspid, and it looks unimpressive when we calculate the prevalence for something like the U.S. population. We're around 0.6% of the U.S. population. Again, when you say it, it doesn't sound like it's big, but you'll see it is big. Because when you look at the calculation with the age and the aging of the population, you're going to have, in the U.S., approximately 1.6 million U.S. citizens that are affected by moderate or severe TR. But what is most important is not just the number, but the incidence of cases. And in fact, what you have is you have people dying with a TR, and they are replaced. So using the mortality rate and the number of cases that we have, the prevalence of cases, we can calculate the incidence. And in fact, what happens is that the mortality rate of TR is at least 10% per year, and I'm going to show you that. So if you have a mortality rate above 10%, you have at least 160,000 new cases per year that are appearing in the US. So that is a very large load of new cases every year that are poorly treated. So yes, TR is a frequent condition and it has to be properly analyzed. Then we're going to go to the second point, which is it treatable? What do we have for treatment? So when you look at the surgical experience published in the Annals of Thoracic Surgery with the STS database, you see that the people who receive treatment have mostly repairs, and only 14% of all the treatments are isolated. The most is the tricuspid valve repair. But what we see with this work of Pat McCarthy is that 5 years post-op, the incidence of recurrent TR is quite high, between 17 and 32%. So a high rate of recurrence of TR post-repair. So you say, okay, we can do a valve replacement. Here is the valve replacement for TR. And what are the results of the valve replacement? Well, I'm showing this as an example of the series that are published. This is a series of 171 patients with TR operated just for the TR. And the mortality in that series was 28%. 28% operative mortality, not very engaging, and explains the bad reputation of the tricuspid surgery. When we look at all the experience in the STS database, what you see is, yes, there is an improvement, a decline of the operative mortality, but still it remains on the left side, you see, between 8 and 10% of operative mortality. So it's a bad reputation for valve replacement. So that with this bad reputation, we start with 1.6 million people in the population, and we have less than 8,000 to 10,000 cases done every year. So TR nationally is not treated. And then when we look at our own experience, the experience in Olmsted County, the Mayo Clinic that surrounds you, you can walk to the hospital, you don't need to have a car. Of all the cases of moderate or severe TR, 2.4% ultimately during their lifetime get operated for that. So an extremely low rate of treatment for TR. So TR is severely undertreated and is it's treatable, but it has high risk and it's severely undertreated. The decisions are made very rarely to treat the TR. But the question is it a serious disease that deserves our attention? Maybe it's not that serious. Maybe we don't need to treat these people. Well, the point that you have to retain is that TR is very heterogeneous. Here are the list that we regrouped. This is regrouped list of the causes or the context, the clinical context for TR, dominated by left-sided valvular heart disease, and very few are organic. Most are functional TR, and you see that when you look at the characteristics of the patient, the ages are different, the sexes are different, but often dominated by female, and the prevalence of atrial fibrillation is quite different. And when you look at the cases, you understand the issue of the context in which it occurs. Here is a rheumatic disease of the tricuspid valve. Would the patient die because of the TR or because of the rheumatic disease of the left side? If we go to another case, here is a carcinoid case. Is the patient dying because of the TR or is the patient dying because of the tumors in the liver? This is a case of organic TR. Is the patient here dying because of the TR or is it because they had a trauma to the heart or a biopsy causing the flayed leaflet and secondary to another case? Here's a patient with a pacemaker-induced tricuspid regurgitation that we put in the organic TR. Is it the TR or is it the reason to put the pacemaker or complication of the pacemaker or defibrillator that is causing that? Pulmonary hypertension, obvious. Is it the TR or is it the pulmonary hypertension causing the death of the patient? And even in the isolated TR, what we call the isolated TR, mostly occurring with atrial fibrillation, is it the TR or is it the atrial fibrillation causing the death of the patient? So from the literature, when you look at the outcome of TR, there are nice curves like this with all the cases together of TR. But again, here, this is heterogeneous. We don't know the symptoms of these patients. We don't know the cause of what's happening. And when you look at the details of these patients, the EF between the grades of TR are very different. So maybe it's the EF killing the patients or the pulmonary pressure. But the pulmonary pressure was measured in a very small number of people. Is it the heart failure killing the patients rather than the TR? So it's very difficult to know if the TR really is the deadly disease. So we looked at our population in Olmsted County again, and even if you have an isolated TR, you see that you have a mortality here that is higher than controls of similar age. And if you look at the yearly mortality, heart failure, and atrial fibrillation in this patient, you see that the rates of complications, death, heart failure, atrial fibrillation, is very high within each clinical context group. Even if you look at the quantified TR, and this is the isolated TR group, you see that we can quantify, and we're promoting the quantification of tricuspid regurgitation, and you can do PISA on the tricuspid regurgitation. It's highly feasible. You have to take into account the angle of the leaflet, the outside angle of the leaflet in calculation, and you can have an ERO and a regurgitant volume, just like with MR. When you quantify the TR, you see that in the isolated idiopathic TR, it is highly predictive. The degree of TR is highly predictive of the outcome, adjusting for everything. And it's true whether you're in sinus rhythm or atrial fibrillation, and it causes excess mortality, and it causes a high rate of cardiac event whether you're in sinus rhythm or atrial fibrillation. So that's a beginning of a proof that TR in and by itself is significant. Another point is the TR associated with left ventricular dysfunction. When we do the quantitative analysis that we published earlier in the European Heart Journal, what we did is we matched the people with TR to people with trivial TR and the same EF and the same age, so we could compare apples to apples. And when you look at that, you see that the people with TR, severe TR, have more mortality than the people with trivial to moderate TR. So there is an inkling that having significant TR by quantitation is saying something. But this was a small number because we are deficient in quantifying TR. We don't do that enough. We do a lot for MR, we don't do enough, and we have to learn to progress on the quantification. So what we did, seeing those results, is we look at the entire experience with heart failure with reduced ejection fraction and look at the tricuspid regurgitation. So we gathered a very large group of almost 12,000 patients, and you can see that almost a quarter of these patients have moderate or severe TR. So if you think in the US, 500,000 heart failure, a quarter have moderate or severe TR, that's a lot of people in the US. So, and when we look in this very large group in whom we have comprehensive information, we see that the TR is highly associated with the mortality following the diagnosis. More TR you have, the more mortality you incur, not just at the beginning, but throughout the follow-up. And this was published 2 days ago in Circulation. And what we see is whatever the adjustment you do, you see that it works. Whether there is right ventricular dysfunction or no right ventricular dysfunction, the TR is predictive of outcome. Whether you have pulmonary hypertension or no pulmonary hypertension or pulmonary hypertension, the TR is predictive. It's a little bit compressed. when there is pulmonary hypertension, but still the TR plays a role in the prognosis of these patients. So when you adjust for everything, TR is a significant predictor of mortality. It is a predictor of poor clinical outcome independently of comorbidity, ejection fraction, symptoms, RV dysfunction, pulmonary hypertension. It is still a very important role in the outcome of this patient. So what have we seen of that public health crisis? It is true, yes, the TR is frequent. TR is deadly independently of all comorbidity or TR cause, and TR is treatment is high risk and severely underused, and we need to define new path. That's the old guidelines, you know, only one class one indication. And when you look at the new guidelines, they are more fancy, but still is only when you do mitral surgery that there is a class one indication. So clearly the guidelines are outdated and we need to work more on the TR. We need to revise the TR treatment option and the TR treatment guidelines. Thank you so much for your attention.